Hi everyone! Today I will show how to simulate a clinical trial in Simulx. In a previous Monolix tutorial, we have modeled a single-dose PK/PD dataset with the PK of warfarin concentrations and the PD of PCA, which is the prothrombin complex activity. We will now use the model in this Monolix project to simulate a parallel clinical trial with two arms. One with a loading dose and one without. And we will check if more patients reach the PCA target with a loading dose than without a loading dose. I export the project to Simulx. In the definition tab, some elements have been automatically defined based on the Monolix project that I imported. So the model has been defined, the population parameters and individual parameters have been created based on parameters estimated in Monolix. I also have some covariate elements that have been imported from the original dataset. Treatment element was also created based on the treatment in the original data, and some output elements have been created based on the outputs of the model and observations of the data in the Monolix project. So now I know that I will look for a multi-dose regimen once per day. So I can already create a new treatment element, which is a regular schedule once per day. So I set an interdose interval of 24 hours. I'm going to start with a dose amount of 1 milligram per day. And I can set a higher number of doses just to make sure I have enough doses to cover the full time of the simulation. More complex treatment options have been detailed in another feature of the week. So that was the feature of the week 99. And the link is just above here in case you're interested. So now I will call this treatment 1 milligram once per day. And I will move directly to the exploration tab. So here in the exploration tab, I see the response of a typical individual to the single dose regimen given in the original dataset. So I can select here the multi-dose regimen that I just created to check also the response to this multi-dose regimen. And as I am only interested in the PD response R, I'm going to remove the output CC. So now I click on apply and the prediction is updated. The yellow curve here corresponds to the response to the multi-dose regimen of 1 milligram once per day, whereas the blue curve corresponds to the response of the single-dose regimen given in the original dataset. First, what I want to do in this exploration tab is see how I can define a good dosing regimen once per day to reach the PCA target, which is a PCA below 35% at 96 hours. So I'm only interested in what happens until 96 hours. So here you see that the output is going too far. So I can edit it here to set a final time of 96 hours only. And I click on apply. And now I'm going to adjust the new dosing regimen by increasing the dose amount to check if I can reach 35% PCA. And you see that with 10 milligram once per day, I reach a PCA below 35%. So I'm happy with this new dosing regimen, which would be a good candidate. So I can create a new treatment element based on this. I call it 10 milligram once per day, and I can replace in the exploration group my older dosing regimen by this new one. I click on apply. Now I could check what happens if I add a loading dose. So I create another treatment, which I will call loading dose. And here I can keep a manual definition of the treatment because I only need to add, for example, 10 milligrams times zero, and I can have another dose at 24 hours to have 10 additional milligrams for the loading dose. And I can add this treatment to a new exploration group. For exploration group 3, I only have the loading dose. I want to combine this treatment by the previous 10 milligram once per day. And now when I click on apply, I see what would happen if, in addition to the 10 milligram at time 0 and 24, I have 10 additional milligrams. So this green curve corresponds to the response to 20 milligram at time 0, 20 milligram at 24 hours, and then 10 milligram once per day. I see that in both cases, for the case with a loading dose and without a loading dose, the 35% target is reached for a typical individual. But in case of a loading dose, I have a better security margin because the PCA is around 25. So if there is some variability, maybe it's a higher proportion of the population, which will be below 35%. So if I simulate now a whole population, will I really get significantly more patients reaching the target when there is a loading dose? To answer this question, I will focus now only on the multi-dose regimen, and I will send all elements to the simulation tab. In this tab, I will be able to simulate the whole population for each dosing regimen to check if these treatments are good candidates for my next clinical trial. To have a good idea of the population prediction, I select a high sample size, let's say 1,000 individuals per group. I want to sample individuals based on population parameters estimated in Monolix, so I use the element MLXPOP. I have already defined dosing regimen for the two groups, which I will rename. So this is without loading dose, and this is with loading dose. I have also already defined the PD output, which I want to look at, which is going from 0 to 4 days. This output uses the smooth prediction for the PD, which is this R output coming from the model used in Monolix. And this will give me a simulation without noise. This is what I want in a first step to compare the two treatments. And finally, assuming I have a similar population as in my original data, I want to sample covariates from the element MLXCovDist, which is a covariate distribution extrapolated from the original warfarin dataset. As in Monolix, I like to save my project somewhere in my computer before I run it, because all the results will appear in a result folder which will be located next to my project file. So this way I know where the results will go. And I run the simulation. In the results tab, I obtain the list of individual covariates and parameters that were sampled in each group. And I also obtain the output statistics for each time point and each group. And I can also visualize this output in the plots, giving me smooth predictions for the PD with empirical percentiles, summarizing the whole population. I can add a visual cue at 35% on this output distribution to visualize better where my target is. And you see that in the case of a loading dose, most of the population reaches the target after 4 days, whereas without a loading dose, almost half of the population does not reach the target. This preliminary simulation with high sample size, fine grid, and smooth predictions shows that a loading dose is relevant. Now we would like to simulate what would happen in a real clinical trial, so with noisy outputs, including the measurement error, and with a limited sampling schedule. My ultimate goal is to assess my chance to get a successful clinical trial showing a higher percentage of individuals in the target with the loading dose. So I come back to the simulation tab to define the parallel trial. Let's assume that we can recruit 100 individuals per group, and in the trial we want to measure the PD response with residual error. So let me show you how it looks in the model. We have the prediction, which is what we currently use in the simulation, which is the output R, which is computed in the structural model. And we have YPD, which corresponds to the noisy observations, so prediction, plus residual error corresponding to the error model that has been estimated in Monolix. So I will change these output elements to use, instead of R, the noisy output YPD. Also, in the clinical trial, we cannot measure all these time points. Let's say we want to measure the PD response once per day. I'm going to set an interval of 24 hours between the measurements. And I rename it measured PCA. These are the two only changes I need to make to have a more realistic clinical trial. And I'm going to save my project under a new name and run. After running the simulation again, I now obtain outputs that correspond to measurements that I would obtain during a clinical trial. After simulating a population in Simulix, it is possible to post-process your output to get some quantitative outcomes and compare groups with a statistical test as you would do it to analyze a clinical trial. The percentiles that I obtained after simulation of the two arms are based on the 100 individual outputs per group. For each of these individuals, we would like to check if the PD is below target at 96 hours. Then we will summarize this information for all individuals within each group to get the percentage of individuals in target at 96 hours. And finally, we will use a statistical test to check if there is a significantly higher percentage of individuals reaching the target in case of a loading dose compared to the percentage when there is no loading dose. This is possible with the section Outcomes and Endpoints located in the simulation tab. So I can click on it to open it, and to focus better on this section, I will close the simulation part. To create an outcome, I can click on the plus here, and the outcome that I will define now is a value that will be computed based on an output for each individual. I want to check for each individual if the PCA is in target, so I can keep this measured PCA as output. Now I will consider the last value per individual, because this is the measurement after 4 days, so this is what I am interested in. And I apply a threshold to check if the value at 96 hours is below 35%. Okay, so the outcome that I create here is a true or false value for each individual. Let me call it PCA below 35. Automatically, when I create an outcome, an endpoint is also created. The endpoint summarizes the outcomes over individuals. In this case, as the outcome is a true-false value, the endpoint can only be the percentage of individuals for which the value is true. If the outcome was a continuous value, such as the Cmax, for instance, the endpoint could also be the mean or median value over individuals. I can rename the endpoint so percentage individuals below 35. As I want to check if this percentage is significantly higher with a loading dose, I set a group comparison with the no loading dose group as a reference. As the outcome is binary, Simulix will perform a Fisher's test to check if there is more chance to be in target with loading dose, and thus I want to set the alternative hypothesis to odds ratio greater than 1. To compute only the outcomes and endpoints, I only need to run the outcomes task because the simulation results are already there, so they just need to be post-processed. So now I have two additional sections in the results tab, endpoints and group comparison. In the endpoints section, I have a sub-tab showing me the outcomes for all the individuals. So for each ID in each group, I can check if the outcome is true or false. The outcome statistics over individuals can also be observed in a plot called outcome distribution. And to compare the plots better, I can visualize them also in a stacked mode. You see that I have more individuals in the targets with a loading dose than without a loading dose. But is this significant? In the group comparison section here, I get the value of the odds ratio and the p-value for the Fisher's test. The clinical trial is a success because the p-value is below 0.05, which is the threshold that I set for success. So for this trial, the dosing regimen with loading dose gives a significantly higher percentage of individuals in target than the dosing regimen without loading dose. So far, I have simulated a trial and predicted that a statistical test comparing simulation groups would give a successful result. This result is dependent on the individual values that have been sampled randomly according to the parameters and covariate distributions. If I redo the same simulation with different samples, I may obtain a different result. This is why we like to simulate trials in replicates in order to obtain an uncertainty on the trial result. I choose to run 300 replicates and run simulation and outcomes by selecting both tasks and clicking on run. First, if I look at individual outputs, I can display the data for each of the replicates by moving this slider. Endpoints are computed over individuals for each replicate study, and the endpoint summary table shows endpoint statistics over replicates. We obtain a new plot showing these endpoint statistics as box plots. The most important result for us is located in the group comparison. We obtain the result of the statistical test for each replicate study. And you see that sometimes the trial was not successful. In the summary tab, we obtain the percentage of success over all replicates, which is also called the power of the trial. So this means that if we perform this clinical trial, we would have 87% of chance to show that the loading dose leads to more individuals in target. In this simulation, I have used the population parameters estimated by Monolix. It is also possible to take into account their uncertainty, and this is shown in another video. The link is there above. To summarize this Simulix tutorial, after exporting the Monolix project to Simulix, we first explored new dosing regimen to find two candidates that lead to the response that we want for a typical individual. We then simulated a whole population in an ideal framework to compare what could be the population response for these two dosing regimen. We then simulated a more realistic trial by adding noise, setting realistic sample size and measurement schedule. We post-processed the outputs to obtain quantitative outcomes and define success of the trial by the result of a statistical test. And finally, we obtained the power of the trial by running replicate studies. That's the end of this Simulix tutorial. I hope this will save you time for your next clinical trial simulation.